Hearing. The title of today's session is Online Teaching Methods, Reskilling Teachers. The primary aim of this webinar is to design and to enhance teaching and learning skills which help faculty to adopt effective educational practices. Our today's workshop would include how technology impacts online instruction, assessing the effectiveness of online teaching learning, and also teaching support for online instructors. Around 550 plus participants have registered from various educational institutions across the country. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome all the participants across the country. I, on behalf of SSMRE fraternity and on behalf of all our participants and on my own behalf, wholeheartedly welcome our today's speaker, Dr. Geeta Rajaram, Principal and Director, Global Institution of Management and Science. We welcome you, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. We welcome you.
Thank you very much.
I now welcome our beloved principal, Dr. S. Anil Kumar, whose long hours and hard work makes such a difference to ensure the best for our students and staff. We are forever grateful for all you do, sir. On behalf of all, I extend a very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay, sir. I now extend a hearty welcome to Dr. Nagaraj, Head Department of Commerce, Coordinator IQAC, for his continued support. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Salma, madam. Thank you. Good evening.
I thank our organizing team who have...
Hello.
I thank our organizing team who have helped to turn the event from an idea into reality and also for their constant support. I welcome you all. I extend a very warm welcome to one and all for today's session. I wish the webinar be successful and reach its goals as mentioned. And I wish all the very best during these 2 days. One humble request for all the distinguished participants, please do abide by the guidelines shared. Need your cooperation. This is to prevent just unwanted background noise and disturbance from distracting the host and other participant as well. So, and if anyone have, that is, any questions during the presentation, please type them into chat box. We will bring them up at the end. Now I request Mr. Shiv Kumar, Assistant Professor, ma'am, Department of Commerce, to introduce our principal, Dr. S. Anil Kumar. Sir.
Okay.
Over to you, Shiv Kumar.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Sir Gokul sir, can you able to present a slide? Gokul sir? Hello? Hello?
Shiv Kumar, it is there. You please carry on.
Sir, slide present. Shiv Kumar, sir,
you can start.
Okay. An organization with good players keeps adding its success. An organization with good leaders keeps multiplying its success. SSMRE College has one of the such good leader is none other than Dr. S. Anil Kumar. Good evening all. It is both honor and privilege to introduce our beloved principal to this webinar. He is a situational leader, visionary and author. He has M.Com and PhD from Bangalore University and D.Lit from the University of Panama, USA. He has 4 decades of teaching experience and more than 2 decades of research experience. He has guided more than 6 PhDs and 31 MPhils. He has published papers in various reputed journals. He has presented papers at Harvard University, USA and Griffith University, Australia. He has authored more than 30 books on various commerce and management subjects. He is a member of Academic Council member, Bangalore University and other academic bodies. He has been awarded the Best Teacher Award by the Rotary Bangalore South and Karnataka Civil Defence Corps, received from the then Governor of Karnataka, His Highness Dr. Hansa Bharadwaj. He has also been awarded Dr. Abdul Kalam Gold Medal Award from the Global Economic Progress Association, New Delhi. He is innovator of 360 degree education for wholeness model at SSMRV College. He has his own website called www.sanilkumar.com. With this brief introduction, I request sir to address the gathering. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Shukumar. Good evening. Yes, I'm very happy to welcome the today's resource person, Professor Geeta Rajaram, who has accepted to be part of this webinar. And also, I'm very happy to see there are about more than 513 registrations for this particular webinar. So this shows the kind of importance given for this particular topic and resource person, and of course the institution which has organized this particular program. I think all of us should feel proud about this, and that too. I saw the list of registrations. I think people from all over India, Goa, even Narthi, everywhere. I think almost all the states, there is participation. And even in Karnataka, there are about 112 participants from different districts. So it shows the popularity of this particular program. So I'm very happy that the resource persons really have a very good reputation in this particular area. And as far as the SSMRV college is concerned, this is managed by one of the most reputed institutions in India, that is RV Educational Institutions, which runs about 22 institutions from LKG to PG and research centers, professional colleges like RV Engineering, Dental, and other courses, and all kinds of courses we run. And SSMRV is about a 35 years old institution, and this is actually ranked as one of the top five colleges in India from since 2018. That is, from past 3 years we have been ranked on among the top five colleges, and of course each department has been ranked very well. And of course, it is also accredited by NAC with A grade. And we have been very popular in South India, and our students are getting a lot of ranks, and our placement rate is about 96%. And of course, a lot of things to say about our institution. We are very proud of it. And this faculty study circle, I would like to talk about faculty study circle. This is a very unique initiative of our college. None of the colleges, as far as I know, is having this kind of an initiative, in which this is we call it as a knowledge platform. I always say that SSMRV College is the knowledge destination, and we have created this knowledge platform for all the faculty members. And once in a month, we invite the faculty members of the affiliated colleges of Bangalore Central University and other Bangalore University and North and South. And about 80 to 100 faculty members will be in our institution to share their knowledge. And on this occasion, we invite the resource person from the industry or the academia to discuss about the recent developments in the particular area. So this is a unique program in our institution, and this is the 19th program we are organizing in this. So And this is managed by the coordinators and the team of faculty members headed by Professor Umay Salma. And of course, it is also guided by Dr. Nagaraj and his team in organizing such program. Of course, all these years it used to be in person, that means in our institution, we used to be given certificates also. But this time we are very happy that we are doing it through online, and we are able to reach out to so many people this time. So I'm very happy, and I appreciate the initiative taken by the faculty study circle team and the Department of Commerce in organizing this particular program. And also I would like to welcome all the participants who have registered to this particular webinar. So really, I think some of you are first timers who are coming to this particular webinar organized by SSMRV College. Please be in touch with us, and you can see our website ssmrv.edu.in for more information. You will know what kind of we are running BCom, BBA, BCA, and MCom course in PG program. Of course, we are also running some of the very unique programs, like in BCA, Enterprise Technology and Data Center Architecture program. And in BBA, we have BBA Aviation program. And of course, this time for BCom, we have made mandatory for all the students to select any one of the three diploma program, which is part of the curriculum, in the sense which is along with the university syllabus, they'll be doing any one of the technology related subject. For example, SAP, ERP system, digital marketing, and analytics, business analytics. Any one of these three is offered along with BCom. It's mandatory. So of course, this is an add-on from the college, free of cost for all the students. So like that, tally is also given for free of cost. So like that, there are a lot of add-ons given to the students, in addition to the personality development and pre-placement training programs, etc. So there are a lot to know about our institution. Please log into our website. You will have more information on that. Once again, I take this opportunity to welcome today's resource person, Professor Gita Adhiram, for accepting our invitation, and I invite all the participants who have taken interest in this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable contribution. Thank you, sir, once again. Now I request Mrs. Shakila, Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, to introduce our resource person of today's event. Dr. Gita Rajaram, Principal and Director, Gurukul Institute of Management and Science. Over to Shakila.
Shakila, thank you. May I take a minute before the introduction is done? Just an important guideline for the participants, if I could.
Yes, sir.
Participants, one thing is, now that on your respective screens, once the resource person starts presenting, there is a small icon that you see that is called pin to screen. Okay, I repeat, there's an icon on the left hand, on this one just next to the mute button, there's a icon called pin to screen. Please, once the resource person starts presenting, please click on that pin to screen, so that you will be able to view the entire presentation without any disturbance. Otherwise, what happens if somebody else is presenting, a ma'am's presentation will go elsewhere on the screen. So I repeat, just there's a small pin button, please ensure that you use that. Okay, somebody else is presenting, please ensure that he is removed. So in the interest of the other participants who are not able to join, we have at present 214 plus, there'll be some others will be joining. So please inform that the session will be uploaded to our YouTube channel, okay, and they'll be able to get log into our YouTube channel and check the links so that if they missed it today, they'll be able to go online for that. So I repeat, please pin the presentation so that there's no disturbance. It's called pin to screen. Pin to screen. Okay, so that was an important update which I had to give you. Shakila ma'am, sorry for that interruption. You could just start the presentation. Mr. Ranganath, please stop presenting. Yeah, thank you so much. Shakila ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to one and all present here. This is Shakila, Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, SSMRV College. We are pleased to have in our midst esteemed resource person, Dr. Geeta M. Rajaram, Principal and Director, Global Institute of Management Science. Dr. Geeta M. Rajaram has a strong academic career of close to two decades. Dr. Geeta is professionally trained in management pedagogy from IIM Bangalore in strategic management. She has authored many articles that have been appeared in both national and international journals of repute. She is also trained for case method teaching at IIM Ahmedabad, organized by Harvard Business Publishing. Being actively involved in teaching management case studies, her innovative case teaching techniques are recognized and widely appreciated. Dr. Geeta is a regular resource person in several MDPs and FDPs. Her area of research are corporate finance, economics, international financial management, strategic management, derivatives, and stock markets. Dr. Geeta has extensive teaching experience, both national and international. She has been visiting professor in Mzumbe University, Tanzania, NMI Institute of Management Studies, Bangalore. She has designed curriculum international programs for ACCA UK for ACCA affiliation, and even she has designed curriculum design of international programs for CIMA UK for CIMA affiliation. She is also well known for her teaching skills in case-based teaching methods, learning strategies, active and blended training. She is a doctorate from Mother Teresa Women's University, Kodaikanal. She has done her MPhil from Madurai Kamraj University. She has completed her PG diploma in portfolio management, Pondicherry University. She has done her master's in financial management from Annamalai University and master of commerce from University of Pune. It is my pleasure to wholeheartedly welcome you, ma'am, for the 19th edition online faculty study circle. Thank you for taking time from your busy schedule and consenting to be our resource person for the day, ma'am. Now, I request Dr. Geeta M. Rajaram to start the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.
Ma'am, you can start the session.
Thank you very much. That was a very warm welcome, and I'm very glad to be here. And my personal thanks to Professor Umay Salma and to Professor Gokul, who have been coordinating it so well to make this possible.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Ellarigu namaskara. Hope all of you are safe and fine. Welcome to a very interesting session on online teaching pedagogy, reskilling the teachers. I would just start with a quote. Education is a manifestation of knowing yourself and the world with intellectual curiosity. What amazing words we have in this quote, right? So I understand that most of you are here because of the curiosity, isn't it? Therefore, learning, I always believe, is an experience, and the rest is just information. What a wonderful quote this is as well. Look at this slide, which is currently now appearing. Best teachers are leaders, and best leaders are teachers. I want all of you to see, look at this again. Best teachers are leaders, and best leaders are teachers. I'll also draw your attention to the small pic which is appearing to your left-hand corner. Take your first step to experience a new dimension to learning. All of us are currently in this situation. We are all taking our first steps towards a new dimension, isn't it? In the ancient Indian context, the methods of learning were segregated into three categories: Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. Shravana means listen to the teacher. Manana, reflect on what was listened to. Manana, I'll repeat, reflect on what was listened to. And then Nididhyasana. Nididhyasana means constant repetition. Shravana, listen to the teacher. Manana, reflect on what is being listened to. Nididhyasana, constant repetition. Don't you think all these still hold good? Right? It does hold good, right? I will just start with a small introduction so that we all get into this whole perspective of why higher education is drawing so much of attention. I'm sure all of you are aware, currently a cabinet meeting, a press conference is also going on the changes expected in higher education. The places of learning are shifting. Earlier, it was collated face-to-face interactions. And then today it has gone into distributed virtual-to-virtual interactions.
Geeta ma'am, can I interrupt for a minute, please?
Yes, sir. Please tell me.
Participants, please pin to the screen, because I myself have done it and I'm able to see the presentation here. Participants who have been putting messages in the chat box saying that you're not able to see the slides, I repeat, please pin to the, when the ma'am presentation is there, it could be on a small chat box. Please click on that pin so that the entire screen, the entire presentation comes on your screen. Okay.
Okay. Can I continue, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. So I was drawing your attention towards how the places of learning is shifting. Earlier, it was face-to-face in a classroom. Today, it has become distributed from virtual to virtual world of interaction. All of you are experiencing it. So it's becoming easier for me to tell what I'm trying to actually bring forward to all of you. When online, it is important to establish a strong teacher presence to motivate the students and ensure they feel cared for. All right. Students actually don't see the online learning difficult, but it is that connect that is missing and they are looking for that connect. So in a matter of weeks, almost all the teachers in our country, for that matter in the world, have changed the way they are teaching, isn't it? All of us are realizing that as soon as the lockdown was announced, we had to move our classes from face-to-face version to the virtual world. Now, before I begin or get into the details of online teaching pedagogy, I just thought I will draw your attention to some of the important facts. And I don't know if you take it as a pride or as a challenge. By 2030, India would be the youngest nation in the world. Most of us are agreeing to this, isn't it? One in every four graduates in the world will be a product of Indian higher education system. So we are contributing 25% of the working population that is from our education system. Now, we as teachers are both looking at this as an opportunity as well as a challenge. So what are the existing challenges? The existing challenges in the Indian higher education comes with reference to the accessibility of education, equity of education, and most importantly, quality. All of you are seeing that I have put quality in a bold. The reason for that is the quality of education is the call for the day. We need to look at this.
Geeta ma'am?
Yes.
So sorry, there are a lot of people have logged in through mobiles. So I think the one of the common concern is they say that the PPT is not visible. Could you please log out and log in again? I mean, can you just stop presenting and start doing it again, just like how we did the other day?
Just all right. All
yeah, yeah, all right. Yeah.
I'll stop sharing, but I will
stop sharing it and then again start it.
Represent it, right?
Yes, sir, it yes. is visible, sir.
No, for the people who are using mobiles.
I'm using mobile. It is visible.
Okay. Probably because in the interest of people in the chat box, people are saying, "Let's try that. Let's try one more option."
So, yes. Could you let me know first? Could you please let me know if it's visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
One minute. Let us give a minute, ma'am. Let us
give yes,
yes, got it now. Yes, I think.
Madam, it is visible. It is visible.
Okay, yes, thank you. And let me just go with the flow right now. So, my deliberations for the today's session is we are looking at teaching pedagogy. But before that, what is more important for us is what are our preparedness before moving online? Are teachers ready? Are students ready? And what are the opportunities and challenges and how do we resolve? This is how my whole flow of the talk would be around. So the first step that we need to take before moving classes online, remember that these are still classes only, right? None of us are perfect even in the face-to-face class. Let us all agree with this, right? So even when we are in the classroom, it so happens that we may not be very perfect. So it's okay that these online classes are still classes, right? Second thing I would like to draw your attention is learn about your students. Generally, in an online class, it so happens that we may have students from across the world. Just like in this webinar, we are having, as our principal was also telling, we have participants from all over the country. We may not know who the participants are. While in your online class, it so happens that you already know your students. So it's good to know the diversity of your students. Secondly, learn about your students because they are also in a situation where they have no books, they have no or less notes, and more so, they are also at home. So let us understand that. Third thing that I would like to draw your attention is, can you orchestrate your class participation the way you do it in your regular class? When you are in a face-to-face class, it so happens that you are able to orchestrate your class with ease because you know who is answering, who is not answering, who are the ones who are not attentive. But this problem all of us are facing as teachers when we are online is the problem that we are not able to orchestrate the class. We don't know who is listening, who is attending, right? So be prepared to relinquish control, okay? The other step that we need to take before moving classes online is to marshal your resources. So first you plan who is available for you to help at the back end, right? And what is available to you? What resources do you have? Do you have textbooks? Do you have support materials? Right? In some cases, you can also look for some senior students who can help you to be online facilitators. See, for example, when I want to conduct a class, if I want to launch a quiz or a poll, maybe I will request some of my senior students or a couple of students to, you know, give me a back-end support so that my concentration is on the activity and not launching the activity. So marshal your resources, right? It's also important, though it may look like as if we don't know that we need to be functionally efficient to keep our laptops, to keep our charges, to see that our data is strong enough. We know that. But just as a hint, before moving classes online, it's important to get a functional setup. What are the various platforms available? See, most of us are using Zoom, Google Meet. We may be using even Cisco WebEx, right? Just try and find out with other colleagues, what are the different methods that they are using? What are the different platforms they are using for their regular online classes? It's always good to know all this before you go to the online mode. Lastly, sometimes to embrace an evidence-based approach, we need to let go of the old approaches, right? It most of us in the initial days, you know, when we all were jumping into the Zoom and Google Meet and things like that, we were little skeptical. We were thinking like, oh, what is this? It's so difficult. I mean, now, we were little rigid in accepting the new methodology, right? So that is where I always want. And normally I host a poll, but anyways, I just leave a thought in all of your minds. Like, what are the major challenges that you are facing as an online teacher? Give it a thought. Give it a thought. Just think for a minute. What is the major challenge? One major challenge. Give it a thought. All right. So having taken stock of what are the things that we need to keep the before we move on to the online mode, I just thought when we are deciding to take a class, whether it's in the face-to-face or in an online platform, the whole objective is teaching effectiveness. Do you all agree with me? It is the teaching effectiveness. So I have just drawn a few things for you here, a small set of elements which I thought, as a teacher, we are primarily looking at synergies. When I say synergy, I mean pedagogical richness. What type of pedagogical tools are you going to use? What is that new thing that you're bringing into your class? What is the analytical rigor you're going to conduct your sessions? And sometimes you also are looking for some insightful analysis from your class discussions, right? So when I say synergy, I mean the pedagogical richness that you bring into your class, which will enable discussions, analytical thinking amongst your students, right? The next one, transferability. Obviously, you know, the ultimate goal of an e-teacher is to transfer the learning objective. Any session will have a learning objective. And how do we transfer this learning objectives? And, you know, a lot of research is going on. Why is learning objective not easily transferable? The teacher always feels that this is the objective I have for today's session. This is what I'm going to teach in today's session. But how many of them are able to receive it at the other end? Right? So that is what measures the teaching effectiveness. All right? Let's move forward. The students will always look for intellectual contribution by the teachers. Just as you are getting prepared for your class, students will also look forward for some intellectual contribution from your end as well, which will determine the teaching effectiveness. Finally, this is a powerful thing which I'm telling you, is the learning experience. The learning experience for the students through, maybe, you know, you can, I know most of you are following methodologies like giving class presentations, group discussions. You can also have some breakout sessions, simulations. Yeah, simulations, you will have to buy simulations. It may be a little expensive, but yeah, if you're looking at the final semester students, you can always think about simulations as well. And gamifications. Make it as interactive as possible so that students can have a learning experience. Now, you all may be wondering, okay, how can all this be done online? We are doing it. Currently, we are conducting online in the online platform, we are conducting GDs, group discussions, of course, presentations by the students. And we have also started with breakout sessions. What I mean by breakout is, in a class of say 60 students, you can divide 10 students in a group, or say 6 students in a group, into 10 teams. And you can give different assignments or different tasks for each of the team. So when you are into the breakout session, the students will be in their own team. They will not be able to interact with the remaining or the rest of the class. They will only interact with their own students' team. Okay, so this is what I was thinking, a few things. I will still take you forward. Now, I'll draw your attention towards these four principles of social learning. Attention, retention, reproduction, and motivation. I'll repeat: attention, retention, reproduction, and motivation. Now, question yourself, can these be replicated online? I'm sure most of you are having a question mark already on your minds. Can we get the attention of the students? Can the students retain the information that we are sharing? Can they reproduce or apply? And how to keep them motivated, right? So these are a few challenges. I do agree with you all. But just think, can these four principles of social learning be replicated online? Before moving classes online, as teachers, we need to rethink the learning contract as, what is the goal? What is the goal? When I say, I mean, how much can I accomplish in today's session? So when you're entering your class, whether it is your campus class or it is in the online form, how much can I accomplish? What all can I do? Right? What concepts can I teach? Okay, that should be very clear with all of you. Secondly, expectations of the students. Now, students will also have certain expectations. Similarly, you also as a teacher will have some expectations from the students. You would expect them to come a little prepared for the classes. You may also plan the timing for your discussions, right? So the participation is orchestrated by you. You can expect that from the students by informing them in advance. Maybe, you know, you also have some expectations from the students to, you know, submit a particular assignment during a given period of time. That is, you would have set a deadline for submission of assignments. Then you ask yourself, do you need to be flexible? Like, you know, I'll give you another 2 days, you can submit it. Or you still want to stick on to the deadlines. So you are setting the expectations. Right? Next, I'll take you to assessments. Assessments, a critical concept, because end goal is you're looking at whether the learning objective is met or not. Now, how do you assess whether the student has understood or not? You can conduct quizzes, you can conduct some tests, right? There are different methods. I will not delve into a lot of those methods, but just ask yourself, do you need to change these assessment methods because students and you both are on the online platform? Just check with yourself these questions. Also, I have a small tip for all of you on class norms. So normally when you are in a regular class, you know your students, you ask students some questions, they raise their hands, or they may even raise and they may answer your questions, right? And make contribution for effective discussions. But now the question is, we are on the online platform, right? So when we are on the online platform, how do you conduct your class? In the sense, how do you manage your students to enter into class discussions? So what you can do is, all of you know that we use a platform where the students have a chance to type something on the chat box, isn't it? And then you can also ask them to write up their questions or their points for discussion in the chat box, or you can ask for a hand raising. You know, they can raise their hands, wave their hands, and then you can draw your attention by raising their hands, and you can reach out to the students. So you should decide what you are going to accomplish in today's session. In order to accomplish that goal, what are the expectations from your end that the students should come for in the class? How do you assess them? And finally, how are you going to conduct your class? That is, how do you organize the discussions and etc. Right? So that's what I meant by rethinking the learning contract. Now, when you move classes online, it's always good to start with a poll question. More importantly, why do you start with a poll question is to know where your students stand. All right. So you will know whether your students have understood it completely, how many students have understood it completely. All this you can gauge through a poll question. All right. And then shift your mindset. I have a small quote for all of you. These days I write a lot of quotes. So the quote which I'm referring is, your class is a function of your energy, attitude, and preparedness. I'll repeat. Your class is a function of your energy, how enthusiastic you are, your attitude, and your preparedness. So if you go well prepared, you are more comfortable, you know that you are going to conduct your class in this way with a lot of clarity, I'm sure you're going to succeed in your class. So I have given an equation. Your class is a function of your energy, attitude, and preparedness. Also, when you're entering your class, think of any three activities that you're going to conduct for the next 60 minutes or 90 minutes. It depends on your class timings. Now, in these three activities, don't forget to include must do and can do. Must do activities and can do activities. So when you're deciding your three activities, you could probably design activities as must do and can do. Think about any activity. It could be in the form of playing videos or images to start a class. Always, you know, keep the students curious. Don't play video every day. So what happens is students will know, okay, ma'am or my professor, my sir is going to just, you know, play the video in the beginning. No, don't do that. Try and use different methods so that, you know, they will be curious. The curiosity should be kept there. Try and do something new each day. You could also share some exercises or worksheets. You can also share YouTube videos well in advance and ask them to come prepared for the activity in your class. I don't know how many of you listen to podcasts. I'm sure most of you do listen to podcasts. You can also assign podcasts by handpicking some students. You ask students who are interested into listening to podcasts, bring them to class with the summarized version. They can actually come down, they can listen to the podcast, and they can summarize it in the class as well. Right? And you can also use another method is to share some stories. It could be your story or the ones that you heard. So the activities can range to any level, any kind of act. It's your arena. It's your boundary. You can choose the methodology that you wish to adopt. Right? So then after you plan your activity, don't forget to include these activities in your teaching plan. Prepare a very well-designed teaching plan and stick to it, right? Suppose your teaching plan probably could include a discussion plan, questions. Sometimes it could be only information kind seeking kind of information, I mean, you know, the activity. So you write in your teaching plan, just write, for this concept, it's going to be discussion. For the other concept, it will be more insightful analysis. For the third one, for this concept, probably, you know, it should be more predictive. Students need to do some analysis. All right. More importantly, collect feedback halfway through in the class. Don't ask for the feedback at the end of the class. Don't ask for the feedback at the end of the class. Please ask midway. This will help you to readjust the way you teach, because you are not seeing the students. You don't know how much is being understood by them, right? So let's move ahead. I request all of you, if you have the pen paper with you, you could actually write down these questions. I would appreciate, because these are critical questions that you need to ask yourself, right? How will I create value in today's class? I will read it very slowly for the benefit of those who are looking at this particular slide. How will I create value in today's class? Ask yourself the second question. What do students expect you to accomplish? See, as teachers, we always expect students to come prepared for a class, right? Or we expect them to behave in or conduct themselves in a particular method, right? Similarly, what do students expect you to accomplish when they are attending your session? Question three, how will I get some early momentum in the class? That is, see, always we all realize, you know, whenever we are able to capture that first 5 to 10 minutes, the class is all set. You are, how do I get that early momentum? Should I share a story or should I share a video? It's up to you. You decide, right? So how do I get that early momentum? Ask yourself this question, right? Next, what is the landscape of the class? When I say, what is the landscape? How is your class? What is the diversity of your class? Right? How are the students? You already know them, right? So it's better that you understand the landscape so that you can fine tune your teaching methods. All right. And then finally ask yourself, what skill do I have and what skill I need to have? What skill I have and what skill I need to have? So essentially, this is very crucial, because you can play on the strength of the skill that you already have. And probably it's good if you can identify what skills you need to have. So that will enable you to, you may be a very good teacher in the face-to-face mode, but when it comes to the online, there may be a few skills which you need to just grasp quickly so that your online class also becomes as effective as your face-to-face class, right? Now, ask yourself these questions at the end of every week, not every day, at the end of every week. Set aside, say about 30 minutes at the end of every week to reflect on whether the answers are still clear to all the 5 questions or have they changed in any way. By doing so, it will enable you to stay on the right track. Actually, it will help you, you know, identify your own area, your teaching methods. Everyone's favorite slide, right? When you're moving classes online. So are students ready? I'm sure I'm seeing all the smiles on the participants' faces, though I can't see all of you, but I'm able to read your minds. Okay, till now everything was like what we should do. Now the fun part comes. Are the students ready? Yeah, let us check, right? So what you can help the students is in finding out the requirements. So just try and find out, do they have what they need to participate in the class? So it could be whether you have sent a PDF file in advance, a worksheet in advance, an Excel sheet in advance, right? So do they have all that ready? Or you are playing a YouTube video, or have you sent that to them in advance, right? Next is, class environment. What are your expectations from the students for the session or sometimes even for the entire course? Now, when I say what are your expectations from the students, you should identify your class environment and its nature, because you know your students, the diversity of students, the intellect levels of the students, right? Then you should also appreciate the team behavior and personal relationships among the students, because students are sitting now at their home, right? So they may not have that emotional connect with their own classmates. They may be missing that community learning. We should understand that. Now, what robustness are you trying to bring in your class? That's also important to enable the class environment. Then, are you able to sense what students are thinking and feeling? I'm sure we as teachers are very sensitive to students' movements and students' behavior. We can gauge what the students are thinking or how they are responding even in the online mode, right? Now, what are your internal conversations? Just out of context, recently I put on a particular write-up in the LinkedIn, and it has been trending now on internal conversations. Now, when I say internal conversation, you ask few questions to yourself, like, you know, am I teaching properly? How am I looking on the screen? How is my voice sounding? Because you are also alone, right? You are also sitting all by yourself in your room, and then you don't know how you're sounding, whether it is audible to the other end, right? And are students understanding? These are a few questions you will have in your own internal conversations, and this may actually affect the way you teach. If you are thinking about all this, you're conversing with yourself, this will affect your teaching methods. As I told you previously, ask feedback from the students in between the class itself. That is, don't wait for the end of the class. And ask the students for some suggestions in their activities that they wish to do. You don't know. Students will come out with amazing activities. When you ask them what type of activities would you like to do, they will also come. And the last part I would say, when you are expecting your students to be ready, shadow the learner. Track them often and understand how they are responding to different classes, to different activities. See, students at times, they may be highly active or highly participative in certain activities, and they may just go into their shell for other activities. So you as a teacher need to shadow the learner. You need to track your students. It is not enough that, okay, my session is done, I am done. It's not like that, right? So this will help you track and understand how they are responding to your activities, right? So let's move ahead. Now, when you're moving your classes online, what should students do to be ready for the online classes? Yes, you have set your norms and your expectations, how your class is going to be, but what should students also do to be ready for an online class? I know this is your favorite slide, and you know, you may find a few things very funny that I'm going to tell now. You ask your students to keep all your accessories ready, like their headphones, charger, laptop, phone, notebook, pen, pencils. Now I know you all are smiling and thinking that, should we tell all this? Don't they know that they should come prepared for this? No, it's okay. It's okay. You tell them. You keep all your accessories together, and then you sit for my class comfortably. You dress professionally for the online class. Obviously, your students also will dress professionally and come. And tell them that, get something to eat or to drink. Have a bottle of water. Have something to munch on. It's okay, because we are on the online mode, right? So Because for you, it could be one session. For them, it is a session after session after sessions, right? Inform about your class engagement with the family members. You tell your students that they are expected to inform their class, their family members that, you know, I'm having a session now with this, with this professor. Kindly don't disturb me. Because many a times all of us have experienced that when we are on the online mode, on the online platform, sometimes a pet is barking or some family member is talking around, right? Many a times this we have experienced. So you tell your students that they should inform their family members that they have a class engagement and that none of them should be disturbing them. The students are also required to sit in a calm room, just as we are sitting, without any other disturbance. And students should be encouraged to make regular contributions to the class discussions and ask some great questions. This will actually enable them to, feel part of the learning, because they are all by themselves. They are missing, as I told you previously, the community learning, the smiles, the way they argue in the class, discuss in the class, all that they are missing. So tell them, encourage them to pose great questions, and you could also help them to come together by assigning some group work through breakout sessions, right? So encourage students to create WhatsApp group, or they can form some Google documents to share their ideas, their discussion points, their contributions for the class discussions. All right. So all this will help students not miss that, class learning. They feel, okay, now we are all a group. Even though we are away from each other, we are working in a group, right? The students should be encouraged to reach out to you as a teacher, because, not every time all the students will be successful in solving a given problem or solving or contributing effectively. So you be open as a teacher to help them out so that it benefits them in completing their project or their assignment, right? And encourage students to take the benefit of online classes, because these days all of you realize, that whatever interviews are happening by the companies are essentially in the virtual mode. So if students become comfortable by making contributions to the class, are able to confidently answer the questions in the class, this will enable the students to get kind of prepared, for the virtual interviews as well. So encourage them to do that, right? Now, I'll take you forward. Now, I know most of you are looking at this, are you connecting with the students? This is the missing point. We don't know whether the students are listening to us, the students are understanding what we are trying to tell. So what you can do is repeatedly check in what way online teaching benefits the students by asking some feedback from them, or create activities which gives that aha moment, wow kind moment when you are on the online platform. Keep the students motivated. It's okay sometimes when you need to be a little, adjusting to certain noises or certain kind of background sounds coming in. We understand, all of us are in the human world, right? So it's all right. So encourage and support them as much as possible to ensure that they have a wonderful learning experience. Now, I have a wonderful template for some of you, which you could probably use. I have developed this template and it is copyrighted. So you can have a look at this. I'm calling it as Teacher Square. Right? You can attempt at this. Have this, and I'm telling you, this is definitely going to help you out when you conduct your online classes. I'm calling it as Teacher Square. First, define. Second, design. Third is assess. All right. Now, when I say define, define what student learning outcomes do you want? What do you want your students to learn? First, you define that. And in order to reach that learning objective or learning outcome, what document evidence do you want? Right? Now, if your learning outcome is well defined, you know your students, for example, I would say, you want your students to know how to do the financial statement analysis. All right. Or say, for example, you want your students to understand Porter's five-force model. Okay. So if that is what your learning outcome is, so what document evidence do you want that the students have understood this? All right. Now, when I say analyzing a financial statement, what document evidence do you want? You definitely want them to do an analysis, a ratio analysis, a comparative statement analysis, and submit that report either in the Excel form or in the PDF form, whatever. That is your discretion. I will not delve into it. So you should not...
I'm really sorry. I'm just getting messages saying that the PPT is not visible. Would you mind representing it?
Yeah, sure. Is it visible now, sir?
One minute, ma'am. Let us see the response in the chat box.
Yeah. Just indicate me, sir, so that I can start.
Yes, ma'am. Just give it.
Gopal, it is visible. Madam, you can carry on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So what I was trying to tell you is use this defined concept. What is this defined concept? You should know, okay, I want my students to know how to make a financial statement analysis, or you want your students to understand the Porter's five-force model. All right. You know your outcome. Now is, how are you going to assess them? In the sense, I won't say assess. What document evidence do you want? You want your students to use an Excel sheet for making a financial statement analysis, or you pick up a company and you want your students to put the five-force model for that company? It's your choice. How you want to do, it's your discretion, right? Next, design. What small specific actions can we take to improve student learning? Now you have your outcomes in place. You know what your students are expected to do. You are helping them also do that. I agree. But sometimes, you know, you have to design and tell them. See, you should tell your students, use Excel sheet. Okay. Or take a company and prepare the Porter's five-force model. Right? You need to design those small actions, because students are students, right? Ultimately, they are learners. We are the ones who should help them out. Right? Then you can also, you know, get into the assessment. This is very crucial. What evidence of student learning will you collect? So you should tell your students, I want this financial statement analysis on the Excel sheet from, you know, for the past 5 years or past 10 years. You should be able to tell them very clearly, and you should tell them how you are going to assess them also, right? So it's important that the student knows how they are being assessed, right? So if you wish, you could also take a screenshot of this and, you know, try and do this. It's going to be a wonderful experience for you. Then people go to the opportunities and challenges for the teachers. And then I will move on to the opportunities and challenges for students when we are going on the online platform, right? Firstly, the best part of going online is the flexibility. Most of the faculties have sessions at their convenience, unlike the regular timetable kind, you know, 9 to 5 or 9 to 4 kind of class. Instead, they can take scheduled classes at their convenience, because a lot of network issues comes. Sometimes, you know, they have other meetings to attend. Probably, you know, the end of the day, we are expected to complete a set of course or set of hours, I would say. So complete that in week. You can take on a Saturday and Sunday also. In my institution, sometimes we do that, right? So you, this faculties have got a flexibility in terms of scheduling classes at their convenience. Also, they have an various methods of teaching also, right? They can play a video, they can give an assignment, they can send a worksheet in advance. So different methods, that's a wonderful thing. The next thing is, of course, accessibility. You know, today we are able to teach not just 60 students, we can teach thousands of students, right, on the online platform. The other day when I was doing a case study method, teaching methods, I had about 1200 participants. So I was then amazed, you know, like thinking, okay, online platform is not just for that, you know, that group. So many accessibility, the incredible reach that we can have is one of the opportunities I feel. Also, there is a convenience in sharing materials and assignments, isn't it? Don't you all think so? That it's very comfortable sharing the materials on WhatsApp or to sending the mails. Even students are able to send their assignments, right? The other opportunity is interaction and engagement. This is very critical. Yes, students want community learning because they miss their classmates. More so, today's learners are digital natives and we teachers are digital immigrants. We have moved on to the digital platform, but students are digital native. They are born in the digital era, right? So that engagement, they find it very comfortable when everything is on the digital mode, right? That's another opportunity. The other opportunity which I would like to emphasize on is plan and enable active learning through interactions, through chat boxes, breakout sessions, GDs, presentations. All this is possible. If you want to look for, you know, experiential learning, send out worksheets in advance, mail it to them 1 week before, or you can say 1 day before, and tell them, go through all these worksheets and come to class for a proper discussion or proper activity, right? Sometimes you can also engage the students with online quizzes, which you can conduct regularly. Maybe, you know, you can conduct quizzes once a week, or once the concept is complete, you want to check whether students have understood, how many students have understood. So you can conduct an online quiz. As I was stressing, if you have the possibility, you can also go for some gamifications and some simulation methods as well. You can make learning more personalized because students feel that the teacher is teaching him or her in the personal space. In a class of 60, you may not sincerely pay attention for all the 60 students all the time, right? But when the student is sitting by himself or herself in the personal space and you are teaching, they feel that, okay, my teacher is teaching me. So that personalized feeling comes handy and probably helpful for the student as well. Now, challenges. I'm sure I'm reading your mind when I'm talking about challenges. Is all the teaching is incredible. The emotional experience is missing, which otherwise is seen in a classroom teaching. We all miss our students, right? When we see blank classrooms today, we are missing the students. And that emotional experience is something that is lost. Next challenge for the student is with reference to the student focus. Students may not be focused due to being at home with pets, with the technology. Probably they'll be checking their phone repeatedly. Or how many likes did I get for my Instagram picture, right? I know all of you are laughing and smiling now. And they students are also new to the online learning, right? Just as we are, they are also new to the online method. Yeah. Therefore, we expecting a perfection is gone. Now let us not see always the other challenge that the faculties face or the other complaints that I receive from faculty members is, you know, they keep on comparing between the online versus the classroom teaching methods. So they say, oh, when we were taking classes in the classrooms, it was like this. Now it is not like this. So stop comparing that and don't expect perfection in the online platform. If you recall, in the earlier slide, I was stressing on quality education, and this has undergone metamorphosis change in the online mode. So course delivery has gone on the, completely on a different mode. So course delivery is becoming another challenge. And students with lower motivation and drive may actually fall behind. They may not be motivated. They don't want to be motivated, basically, right? So they are not comfortable. So they don't want to participate or become a part of any discussion. Now, students learn that the faculty members are also not trained to design some multimedia presentations. When you are conducting the online class, students are seeing you through. They are knowing like what tools you are using, what platforms you are using, what multimedia techniques you are using. They are also reading you. They are also judging you is the word I would use here, right? So these are few of the opportunities and challenges that the teachers are facing when they are looking at the online platform. Now, when we are looking at the opportunities for the students, because unless we tell the students that these are some of the wonderful opportunities that they have, the first one I would stress is the personalized learning. So when a student is sitting in his or her own space, they feel that the teacher is teaching only them, which may not be available in a face-to-face class. So personalized learning. They can also get actively involved by asking some great questions, contributing to class discussions. And you know, some of the students are normally shy in a class because they would think, what others will think about me if I say this in my class. But in the online platform, the students may actually make some wonderful contributions for class discussions, right? And they can get involved with active learning mode by who are otherwise shy in the class may actually make good contributions when they are on the online mode. And class notes that you people send as faculty members, they become educational vehicles for them because students can refer back to your recordings at their convenient time, isn't it? As I was telling you, students are digital natives and they feel very comfortable and adapt very quickly to the digital mode of teaching. And they also have this flexibility, as I was telling you, they can record your classes and they can listen to your classes at a later point of time. Now, a word of caution, some of the faculties may not appreciate it, but the end goal is the student has to understand and the learning outcome is to be derived. That is what is something that the opportunity is available for the students. So these are the integrated outcomes of the opportunities for the student is through personalized learning, active learning, and flexibility. Since they are digital natives, it becomes very comfortable for them to adapt to this, right? Now, let us look what are the challenges that the students themselves are facing when they are on the online mode. Now, learning has undergone complete change, the virtual mode, no real face-to-face interaction with fellow students and with professors also, lack of social contacts and in-class experience. Students are finding it hard to stay motivated and to be present. I would put it within quotes, to be present or to show up for the session. So students are finding it a little demotivated because they're not able to see their teachers. They're not able to see their own classmates. That is what they are missing. The next thing I would say is the adaptability. They are also struggling. They are also new to the online learning method. They have some network issues. Sometimes, they have some technical issues. Because some of the students attend classes over their phones, they may not have a laptop, they may have network issues, as I was telling you previously, and time management, because they should be motivated, they should take the interest in attending sessions as well, don't you think so? And some of them are not computer literates also, they don't know how to go about a few things when the teacher is sharing in advance or expecting them to submit their assignments in a particular format. These are the challenges that the students can also have when they are on the online mode. The other one is the attention span. See, normally, according even in a face-to-face class, according to a recent survey, in your 60-minute class, the attention span is said to be less than 6 minutes, so less than 10%. After 6 minutes, their mind shifts, even in a face-to-face. So you know now when on the online platform, what is the attention span likely to be? They are more drawn into checking mails, chatting with friends, surfing the web while attending your classes also. So staying focused is a big challenge. The other thing that I would like to say is information overload. The faculty members may be super excited to, you know, share as much as possible with the students, and they may send, say, some 50 pages of PDF and some 5 or 6 videos to watch before they come to the next class. So student will start wondering, oh God, should I read all these 50 pages? Should I go through all these videos? So, you know, sometimes an information overload may demotivate the students to take up the online session seriously, right? So now these are some things that I have over the experience and talking to my colleagues and my academic friends collated all this. Now when you're looking at the opportunities and challenges, remember that there are opportunities as well, and these challenges can be overcome. Now, attention to the teachers is, what have you learned about the why of students are not making desired progress? Why are students not making desired progress? Now, this why should be answered by you. You can find a way out. What specific learning needs have you discovered? Your class is facing some difficulty. For example, I'll tell you, if you have conducted a quiz and 90% of the students have passed the quiz, passed in the sense they have scored 6 out of 10 questions, 90%, it means that there are only 10% of the students who need to be attended to, right? But if you see that only 60% of the class has passed your quiz, it draws your attention, it calls for attention from your end. You should find out, okay, only 60% have understood this concept. That is why they are not able to answer all the questions. Not many have attempted the quiz questions. So you need to revisit that and try and see what you can do about, you know, the learning needs of the student, right? Also, what they need more and what they need less. I'll underline the word what they need more, identify that. Also identify what they need less, right? So I will take you to another canvas which, you know, all the teachers can use this template for their class or even for their course. And again, I say this has been developed by me and copyrighted as well, but you can always use it, giving me the due credit. Now, the student canvas, how are you going to use the student canvas is identify the needs of the students, right? As I told you, the learning needs have to be identified. You identify the needs and say, and find out, try and fill in this particular template. What does the student say about the activity, about the quiz, about the, the discussion? Watch it carefully, right? And what does the student do when you're posting a poll question or when you're posting a quiz to the students, what does the student do? Do they attempt? Do they don't attempt? Observe that. Next, fill in this matrix, which is at the lower end. What might be the student thinking? Why has the student not attempted? Or why has the student made this kind of class contribution? Why did he make this point in the class discussion? What is the student thinking? Try and fill this as well. And then, how might the student feel? Now, when you're putting the result sheets out or you publish the internal assessment marks, how do the students feel? When you're publishing the quiz marks, how do the students feel? Watch this. Now, I'll draw your attention towards the right side of the slide, which says observe and infer. Now, very interestingly, I have written observe at the top and infer at the down, because what the student says and what the student does, you need to observe. Clear? And then what the student thinks and what the student feels has to be inferred by you. So observe and inference. Based on this, try and fill in the last column, which I call it as insights. You will get a feel of your class. You will know 60% of the students failed in the quiz. Why? What did the students respond? To which of the concepts did they respond? What did they do? Right? Answer all this. You will be able to reflect and put on to the insights. This canvas will actually help you, you know, when you are using for one class or for the entire course in the semester, right? I'll take you to another wonderful grid. This grid, again, I have implanted keeping learning complexity versus teaching complexity, right? So I will help you understand how to read this learning grid. Learning complexity is low. Teaching complexity is also low. I will go a little slow. I will tell this again. I have implanted the learning grid in terms of learning complexity and teaching complexity. When learning complexity and teaching complexity both are low, knowing level is more than enough. In the sense, if there is learning is also low, teaching complexity is also low. So learning is easy, teaching is also easy. We are at the knowing level. Hope I'm clear to all of you. So at the knowing level, you can just share a material, some materials, because learning is easy, teaching is also easy. Share some reading materials, or you can just conduct some quiz and know what is the knowing level of the students, right? So let's go ahead. I'm taking you to the doing level now. So at the doing level, teaching complexity is very high. Teaching is very difficult, but learning is simple. All right. Making them understand is difficult, but learning is simple. So what you can do is probably you can encourage presentations, group discussions, live projects, right? Doing level, enable them to do, because learning is simple. Teaching gets complex. So let involve the students and let them do. That is the doing level. Okay. Am I clear to all of you? Hopefully I'm audible and clear to all of you. Then let's move to the other side of the matrix, where I will take you to where learning complexity is high, but teaching complexity is low. Means learning is difficult, but teaching is simple. Repeat. Learning is complex, but teaching is simple. We have to bring the students into the being level. Now, when I say being level, maybe you should involve students in experiments, some lab sessions. These days, we also have virtual labs going on, right? And my favorite, involve the students in case studies, right? So when teaching is simple, but learning is complex, use experiments, use worksheets which will enable critical analysis, lab sessions and case studies, so that the students will play the role of the characters in the case studies, involve them being in that being level, right? Now I will take you to the last quadrant where teaching complexity is high as well as the learning complexity is high. Teaching is also difficult or complex. I would not say difficult, it's complex, and learning is also complex. So at this point where it is teaching is complex and learning is complex, we have to go for the blended level or hybrid level. So in this hybrid level, we may have to have a combination of face-to-face class and virtual classes continuing, right? So most of us are thinking that once this COVID thing is all over, we are all going to get back into classes. But I sincerely encourage you, part of your classes which can be conducted online should be conducted online, and part of your classes which need face-to-face need to be conducted. So we should adapt to the hybrid mode of learning. So you can also involve some of the students who are interested in research. You know, there are students, you can encourage them to get into some paper publications along with you or paper presentations along with you. There will be one or two students in every class who are looking for, you know, some kind of encouragement from your end. So this is how I have plotted the learning grid. And any questions from your end, I'll be taking it at the end of the session. Now, having discussed so much about online classes, opportunities, challenges, now how do we actually resolve? See, currently what we all are teaching is not the online method at all. What we are doing is the university has developed a syllabus and we are just pushing the entire syllabus in the online mode. In fact, the curriculum that has been developed is not meant for online method at all. That is the whole problem. That is why we need to prioritize our teaching objectives when we are teaching online, right? We also have to imbibe some hard, and I won't call soft skills, I will call them as powerful skills. Hard and powerful skills while teaching. Be tolerant. It's okay if there is a technical glitch. It's all right if there is a time lag in discussion. You wanted to complete this, but due to class discussion, you could not complete. It's all right. No, don't worry. Be tolerant is what I'm trying to say. Plan your student engagement. When I say plan your student engagement, I say that you should encourage students to chat in the chat box or ask questions in the chat box, or even you can ask your students to raise their hands. Now, a word of caution, faculty members, to all of you is, don't allow old hands waiting. When I say old hands, if the student has raised the hand and you have moved on to the next concept, the student hand will be still raised. You will not know what question he was asking for, because you have moved on to the next concept altogether. So don't never allow old hands to keep waiting, right? Also, encourage students to make some, contributions in doing the right things. And if any student is disturbing your class, you can actually put them on a private chat and tell them that you are being watched, or we are looking at you, or sometimes it is going beyond you. Just ask them to leave the session. And if you have the opportunity, just remove them from the class, right? And then you can also, as I was telling you, you can encourage students to make certain kinds of group discussions, like, you know, in teams, you can ask them to work. And another method for teaching online is to, you can share the whiteboard. I know it is not as good as your blackboard is. It's not as comfortable as your blackboard is. Therefore, you can share your own whiteboard, and you can write on the whiteboard, so the student feels that you are writing something on the board, right? That catches their attention, other than just playing some PPTs or videos. Sometimes you can also use a blank PPT and type it in front of the
screen. Madam, screen is not visible.
All right. Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am. Now, please carry on.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So I was telling you, you can share your whiteboard and write it on the whiteboard. And another tip I have is you can use a PPT, a blank PPT, and type the points in front of the students when you are discussing the points. Or when the students are giving you some points, type it in front of them on the blank PPT. They feel engaged. Students will feel that kind of, okay, means that topic is being discussed and it's been written in front of them, right? You can also, as I was telling you, host polls, share the poll results with them. And then discuss about the poll results. You know, when you say, for example, what are the challenges you are facing as an online learner? And give them A, B, C, D options. They will choose. And then you can give them an reflection about the poll results, right? And summarize, see this, I have another tip for all of you. You can summarize the entire chat box discussion. Whatever students have discussed in the chat box, you summarize that, right? And make your presence felt at every point. Make sure your footprints are there in the online class. That will help students to remain focused. As I was telling you, if students are doing the right thing, encourage them, reach out to them, and let students feel that their points are also taken into consideration, and they will start making more contribution for the class. Another tip I have for all of you is let the students know their grading rubrics. That is, whenever you're giving any assignments or any activity, tell them beforehand what is expected out of them and how are you going to grade them, or how many marks you are going to give for this activity, for the next activity, for the third activity. How are you actually grading them? If they know that, it becomes very easy for the students to, you know, they will actually be able to reach your expectations because they know clearly what is expected out of them and how they would be graded, right? So these are some typical tips I thought I should share with you. You can also, submit your top three best comments or discussions of the week. You can post it on your blogs, or you can tell during my session this week, these were the top discussions by my students. The students will be elated. They will be happy that their discussions are being taken very seriously by the teacher, and the teacher has posted it on his or her blog, right? At the end, you know, the whole thing is we are trying to tie up everything, discuss, and help as best as we can as teachers. I have a word, something called as feed forward. Feedback versus feed forward. What I mean by feedback, all of us know. Whenever we correct the assignments or anything, students hardly revisit their assignments. They will not bother to check about their suggestions or comments being given by their professors, right? Most of you agree with me. So my suggestion is be feed forward. So share the assessment criteria well in advance. Tell the students what is expected and how you are going to mark them, or how you are going to give grades to them, right? This will help, you tell them in advance rather than telling it after the assignment has been submitted. Okay, so I'm glad that most of the concepts that I tried to share through my experience is been well taken for all of you. Now coming to some of the EdTech tools, I'll quickly go through, and this slide is available to all of you. But currently what I am using is Nearpod, the last but one, and Mural. These are some wonderful tools that I have used, and they are very simple, and some of them are even free for a certain period of time. So I request all of you to go through these tools once and take your call. These are some EdTech tools which are available to all of us for that matter. And I'm doing a case study teaching method for one of the institutions in Bangalore on 3rd of this month, the next month, 3rd August, where I'm going to show them how to use this tool, the last tool called Mural. So this is an engaging tool. The how to do case studies online is you can use your students for engaging themselves into this model, which is built in by Mural. So I'll quickly go through this. These are wonderful tools. These are very popular tools. But personally, I have used Nearpod, which helps you in story writing. And I have also used Mural. I know you all love my grids. So I have gone to another grid where it shows effort impact grid. As you all know how to read grids these days, I would give this grid as a bonus for you. Here, I have tried to implant learning impact versus effort. The efforts that you people put in versus the learning impact. So I'm sure this is self-readable. Now you know how to read the grids, right? Low effort, high impact. Low effort, low impact. Right? So this is a very simple way of understanding the effort impact. So what you can look at is your teaching method can come here. So when the learning impact is low and the effort is low, just, you know, expand. Just keep on explaining to the students what is available, share the materials and things like that. But when you're looking at learning impact to be high, you allow students to explore, allow them to explore, all right? When your efforts are high, but the learning impact is low, you could probably use experiments, right? Some worksheet experiments or some lab sessions, these can be given. But I would encourage when your efforts are very high and the learning impact is very high, you need to embed the blended methodology, which I was telling. You need to go for both face-to-face as well as the online method, right? So I'm sure you all appreciate this particular grid as well. As I say, to conclude, critical reforms are waiting to happen in the education sector, at least in our country. As I was telling you, we are going to contribute 25% of the global workforce, right? So definitely Indian education system calls for some reforms. Students are also not exposed to online learning in the past. They are missing live participation. And, you know, they are also missing their own classmates, professors. And this has kind of created a lot of distance. As educators, we need to be willing to experiment. And this is very unsettling both for the teacher as well as for the student, right? And I leave you with these thoughts. I thought it is important not only to teach students how to interact with technology, but I'm stressing on this point, all of you should and will agree with me that we are not teaching only how to interact with technology, but we are teaching them the skills that cannot be automated in the near future. Like, you know, the emotional skills, the negotiation skills, these cannot be automated, right? Therefore, we are also grooming the students to become future citizens of the world, right? And I leave you with this thought. Your class is a function of your energy, attitude, and preparedness. After this crisis subsides, hopefully, we all expect the best for our students. And we wish our students come back to our classrooms and continue. Or would we find an alternative? I don't know. Thank you all for this opportunity. You can reach me on this mail ID, rajaram.geeta@gmail.com. And also find me on my LinkedIn profile, which is currently on your slide. Thank you all. And now I'm open to questions. I will stop sharing, Gokul sir, if you can help me out with the questions. I'll stop sharing this.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Participants, instead of unmuting yourself, because if all of you unmute, there's going to be a chaos. So please type your question in the chat box so that we can take it up with ma'am right now. If you have any, in the interest of time, we'll be able to take a couple of questions. Since ma'am has already shared her contact details, in case of any questions, you could mail it to her directly after the session as well. So with regard to today's session, any questions are there? One or two questions, we will be able to take it if you type it in the chat box as soon as possible. Okay, ma'am, there's a question. Let me read it out for you. Yes. Maybe, as per the draft NEP 2020 document, the fundamental pillars are access, affordability, equity, quality, and accountability. To what extent can an online class help in achieving it?
See, so, as I started off with this session itself, I said, yes, NEP is focusing on accessibility. I do know that with the online platform, lot of accessibility, we are able to reach large number of students. I know there is a technical glitch. You all may say data availability or network availability. I do agree, but I agree with you all to a certain extent that we need to build a strong digital infrastructure to make accessibility possible. But when it comes to quality teaching, I will assure you that I have been into the online teaching for about past 3 years now. And even before the COVID, I've been teaching some of the executives. So I am on the online platform and it is an amazing way to reach out to large number of students. So quality of teaching depends on the teacher. So that is how I would answer this question. Hopefully, I don't know who has asked, but I thank you for the question and hopefully I answered that.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. I think that answers the question. I have a question from Chitra Ravi Shekhar.
Okay.
Probably the last question. If let me just go up, because since the question, since I can find some, the question seems to have eclipsed here. Okay, the question is, if the student is neutral in spite of trying all the teaching methods, what is the best way to get his or her response and interest?
I will try and answer this. I'm not sure if that is the solution, but I wish that you push the learning onus on the student, because if the student doesn't know why they are learning a concept, probably they will not appreciate what they are learning at all, right? So the onus of learning lies with the student. The whole problem starts when the faculty takes that. They feel it is their responsibility to make the students understand. Right? So most of us are suffering because of this only. We think we have to make the students understand. No, it is not that. They have to take the onus of learning. But it is you as a teacher who has to tell what is the learning objective. If they know why they are learning, probably that will fall in a place. And ma'am, at the end, thank you for the question. But at the end, I would like to say, if they don't want to help themselves, then even God would not help them. Hope I answered that question, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I hope that I think the session is so this one that we are tempted to take a couple of more questions, ma'am. I hope you are okay to answer that.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So the question here is, Mr. KB Ravindra asks, your frank view on which is more effective, classroom or online?
Propose, and it is going to the future also, is blended learning or hybrid learning. As I told you, what all can be taught in the in the knowing level, if you have followed my grid carefully, you have seen that knowing level, just define what is type and all, you can actually share the material with them, right? So blended learning is going to stay. For the other skills, I was telling, not only the regular class, I'm talking to you about the other skills, emotional skills, negotiation skills. We can still go on the online platform. So face-to-face, I know, because most of us are comfortable face-to-face, we say, yeah, let students come back to classes. I agree. But don't miss this opportunity of, having a blended learning. What can be taught online? Try and teach online. Because students are tech-savvy. They want something like that. So you design something which will suit that. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Thank you. Just one question from one of our colleagues, Mr. Satish. Okay.
Yes,
so the question is quite interesting. So, yes. What sir wants to know is, of course, nowadays we assess students with the MCQ. Okay, quantitative questions with the options given. But is there some way where the student can be the assessment of a student can be done if the questions are descriptive through an online method, of course. That is one question.
Given another opportunity, probably I could go for that webinar on assessing as well. But to take this question, I just wish to say the goal is the end point. Like, why are you assessing? What is that you are assessing, right? So if you as a teacher is aware what is expected out of a descriptive question, instead of calling it as a descriptive question, what is the end goal? What is the learning objective that you want to assess? Like I gave you the example, financial statement analysis or Porter's five force model, or for that matter, any of the concepts you can take. So if you know what you're trying to assess, then the methodology comes into place, right? So how do you want them to do? You want them to do a presentation, you want them to do a case study analysis, or you want them to do an Excel sheet workout, right? So the end goal should be clear to you as a teacher. Then the design will automatically come through.
Okay. Thank you, Sati sir. I hope that answers the question. And couple of questions, I'll kind of consolidate those questions, the question is the same question which is kind of asked differently. Is there something of assessing malpractices in an online session?
Sir, I cannot get the question, sir.
Is there any way that all the for example, now the student is online, you are not seeing him or her physically, how do you know whether he or she has done it originally and has not copied it from any other source?
There are a couple of things running into mind for this question. What you can do is probably you can have group questions, like you can ask two or three students to work at your question. And typically don't ask what is type of question, what is this, define this, give two examples. Please don't ask those type of questions. Ask the questions or your assignments or in your test, ask such questions which calls for some critical thinking. See, currently what we have done, I will share if you don't mind, is we have actually posted case studies to our MBA students. So what happens is, every student will come with a different answer. There is no way that the students can actually take from each other, right? So they could copy. So it depends on what type of questions you are posing. If you are posing them easy questions, which is available on Google or on your work document that you have sent, they will just click onto your PPT. They will write the same answer and send. You share material, but ask critical questions where, you know, they have to think a little and write. Hope I answered that question.
Perfect. And some questions I'm skipping because they are not related to today's seminar, for example, about employability and all. Sorry, I'm not able to take that question because it doesn't pertain to today's session. We may have to take a different one because that was not the context in which we are. And regarding feedback link, please remember, sir, it's a two-day event. So we have concluded only today's session. So tomorrow also we have a session with a different resource person. So post that, we are sending the feedback link to all the participants. So till then, please wait. Okay. And with regard to today's PPT, ma'am, if you could please send it to Ms. Salma, ma'am, she will send it to the participants, the PPT, the presentation that has been done today. And we have been receiving excellent feedback on the presentation that has been done.
Thank you so much, sir. And I thank all the participants for sparing their time, especially, you know, having a working day and then getting back to a workshop of this the webinar of this kind calls for real interest. And thank each one of you who is here for your patient hearing. Hopefully I made some sense and gave some insights to your, I think you will change the way you look at your online classes from now on, and try and use out the EdTech tools that I have shared. And I take again this opportunity to thank the principal of SSMRP College, Dr. Anil Kumar, and Professor Nagraj as well, the HOD of the Department of Commerce and Management. And special thanks again to Professor Umesh Salma and Professor.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
We come to the end of it. And maximum by today or tomorrow morning, the recording will be uploaded to our YouTube channel and we'll send the link also. So that should be ready. Maximum by tonight or tomorrow morning, it will be ready. So with that, we come to the end of today's session in terms of the panel. And now I request Umay Salma ma'am to give the closing remarks. Over to you, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Once again, thank you. It was really a wonderful session, ma'am. Extremely informative. Thanks for enlightening all of us through your presentation on the right way to apply various methods. We appreciate you for personally giving timely information. The positive responses what we see in the chat box to the webinar are a reflection of the acceptance and the appreciation from the participants. And yes, ma'am, I would like to highlight an important part of today's event is the teachers required, and then where you have emphasized on define, design, and assess, and what steps do teachers need to take before moving to their class. And overall, as always, ma'am, opportunities and challenges for the teachers and how to resolve in order to reach the desired outcomes. This was really excellent. Hope all the participants have learned and taking back fruitful insights which enable us to rethink and redesign teaching pedagogy to make online class effective. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you once again on behalf of all and the SSMRE fraternity. I once again thank you, ma'am. And and I thank all the participants for your cooperation in making today's event a grand success. Now I request Mrs. Rupa B., Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, to propose formal vote of thanks. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Over to Rupa now.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Good evening, all. On behalf of SSMRV College, I, Rupa B., Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, extend my vote of thanks. Today's resource person, Dr. Geeta M. Rajaram, Principal and Director, Global Institute of Management and Science. It's been very informative session, ma'am. What you explained today was very informative. Thank you so much for your knowledgeable time. And I extend my gratitude to all the participants for your active participation throughout the session. I would like to thank our beloved principal, Dr. S. Anil Kumar, for his guidance and continuous support. I thank Dr. Nagaraj, Head Department of Commerce, IQAC Coordinator, for his support. And I also thank the coordinator of the program, Mrs. Umay Salma, Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, and the entire organizing team for their contribution for this online faculty study circle. Once again, thank you all for the wonderful program. Thank you.
So please join us tomorrow, because tomorrow we will the topic that will be that we will be discussing is on let me just switch it on. So tomorrow's session will be retraining and reskilling teachers. So the resource person for tomorrow, that is day two, is Dr. Neera Vyas, who is the in charge director and associate professor, Sri Swaminarayan Institute of Management, Porbandar, Gujarat. So please ensure that you log in by 4:45 tomorrow. Please ensure that you stick to the same guidelines. Thank you for being such a patient audience. We can understand that there could be some disequilibrium when we start off, but that's kind of okay. But tomorrow, let's ensure that we have a smooth presentation. Okay. Thank you so much. Have a nice evening, and we shall look back tomorrow. Thank you so much. Now I request the participants to leave the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Gokul. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nagaraj sir. Good night. Namaste.